Welcome to our second Diefenbacher webinar. My name is Dennis Hemminger. I'm the Area Sales Manager for North America. And together with my colleague Marius, we are going to give you in the next minutes an insight into Diefenbacher's intelligent air management system.
Hello, everybody. My name is Marius Frier, and I'm a technical sales engineer for the Environmental Technology Department of Diefenbacher. I'm responsible for giving technical advice to our customers in the area of compliance with emission limits and optimization of air quality in production buildings.
Let's take a brief look on our agenda for today. At the beginning of the webinar, we are going to outline for whom our intelligent air management is of great interest. Furthermore, we will provide you with an understanding of the challenges of air management systems in production buildings, of the wood-based panel industry, and outline the limit values. The next step will be to demonstrate how Diefenbacher develops an air management concept which meets your requirements and introduce methods and tools for this purpose. You are welcome to address and enter your questions at any time in the chat. We will gladly answer those at the end of the presentation. So let's start, Marius. What are our customers' challenges and why do they need our expertise in the field of air management?
Basically, we need to focus on two basic challenges. Firstly, we need to consider that due to the production, huge amounts of air exhausted from the production building. Examples of this include the exhaust systems of a forming station, scalper, press, source, and sanding line, as well as material transport systems such as the reject. Depending on the size and complexity of a plant as well as the whole sections, this can amount up to 500,000 cubic meters per hour, or 2.2 million gallons per minute. If exhausted air is not replaced in a controlled way, it will take this way through the building openings such as doors, gates, and windows.
And this leads obviously to uncontrolled air movement in the building, right?
Exactly. And this is the second challenge that should not be underestimated. There are emission sources of highly polluted air in the production line. These emissions are particularly high at the press, at diagonal and trimming saw, whereby these are often enclosed, as well as in the area of the cooling stars. Due to uncontrolled air flows, these emissions are diffusely distributed through the production building.
And an intelligent air management is able to regulate all the air flows in a production building, I guess.
Among others, yes.
The intelligent air management is, of course, not limited to greenfield projects. It is also possible to improve the air quality in existing production lines and buildings. What are the differences here and what is our approach?
Definitely. With greenfield systems, we can take our concepts into account during the planning stage, which means having every opportunity to create an acceptable hall climate from the very beginning. For existing plants, we work even more closely together with our customers. In order to find out how we can achieve the most improvement with efficient effort, the goal should be to reuse existing equipment as much as possible and also to keep investment and operating costs low.
You already mentioned that the production buildings are usually very large and each machine has a different influence on the emissions. Could you please give us an understanding on how to control these large air volumes and thereby achieve a positive impact on the air quality?
Yes. As you can see in this sketch, the airflows in a production building are mainly influenced by thermal effects. The main heat flow is a result of gases, which means which exhaust from the hot press and rise upwards under the hall roof. This also happens at the cooling stars, for example. Due to transmission and radiation heat, the air is set in motion further and partly pushed down towards the floor again. That is the main working area of a stuff, so it must be protected at all times.
So as a result, and in case no measures will be taken to comply with all those occupational exposure limits, the consequence is obviously that your employees have to wear respirators.
Exactly. To avoid this, intelligent air management comes into the picture. On a case-by-case basis, we must decide what measures are taken to capture the contaminated vapors, for example, diffuse and concentrated exhaustions, and replace them with a directed fresh air.
But it appears on the shown picture that the air in the upper hall area is still contaminated. Only down there, in the working area, the air seems to be better.
Yes, that's correct. Intelligent air management also includes keeping an eye on the cost-benefit balance. The effort to comply with the occupational exposure limit at every location in the hall is not proportionate. Therefore, we look at the situation in cooperation with the customer and decide together where the employees' work areas are mostly located. That's where we create an air quality in which respiratory masks do not have to be used.
All right, and thanks for the explanation. So we now got a closer look on the general goals in terms of air quality, but how about measurable goals? Could you please address firstly the quantitative goals that have to be achieved in order to comply with the occupational exposure limits, and secondly, while being responsible for the North American market? I know that there are different limits compared to Europe. Can you also outline those differences just as an example?
Yes. Occupational exposure limits for formaldehyde differ by region. In the past, each member of a European Union had its own limit values. Starting July this year, the new EU directive is going to come into force. And then 0.3 ppm for long-term exposures and 0.6 ppm for short-term exposures will apply everywhere throughout the European Union. In the US, 0.75 ppm applies to long-term exposures and 2 ppm to short-term exposures. Canada has restricted limits values with 0.1 and 0.3 ppm.
Okay, thanks for the overview here. Can you please explain, as you mentioned, long-term and short-term exposure, what this means in this case and in practice?
Sure. That means we are back to the topic of working areas. As already mentioned, together with the customer, we work out the most important areas of work. For example, on the floor level around the press. These areas, the goal is to reduce formaldehyde levels to the point where it is possible to work without protective equipment. In the other areas, where the value is in the range of a short-term exposure limit, the employee may only work for a maximum of 15 minutes without respiratory protection. If a long-term exposure limit of formaldehyde is exceeded permanently, a mask must always be worn. These exposure limits are those applicable to Europe. For other countries, the limits differ accordingly.
All right, we now know the basics regarding exposure limits and working areas. Then, let's dive deeper now into the realization of the measures that have to be taken to improve the air quality in our customers' production buildings. Our customers generally appreciate us for our modern working methods and for always being involved in new developments and state-of-the-art technology. Can you tell us, why is our air management so intelligent?
We have gained a lot of experiences in the recent years and have created an advantage, especially with regard to the use of innovative tools. These techniques are particularly helpful for existing production buildings. With 3D laser scanners, we can record the geometric conditions in the buildings and use this model to design directly with the real conditions. This avoids collisions and take into account all machines and ductwork. As a useful side effect, the customer receives up-to-date CAD drawing of his as-built system. Based on this 3D scan, we then create a CFD model to determine future action from the as-built calculation. Furthermore, we carry out different analyses like pinch point or process integration in order to create a heat recovery concept for unused energy.
You mentioned just shortly CFD simulations. Let us focus now a bit on that topic in the next minutes, because we have invited an expert in fluid mechanics to join our webinar today and are pleased to welcome Matthias Schumacher. Matthias, thank you very much for coming and joining. Matthias, you work for the company IX Process, and you can for sure tell us a bit more about CFD simulations.
Hello, Dennis. Hello, Marius. CFD stands for computational fluid dynamics and is nowadays a widely accepted tool in the field of computer-aided engineering. With this tool, We set up a digital twin of the press horn to analyze and optimize the airflow in such a complex multi-suction and multi-inlet environment. Based on physics of hydro and thermodynamics, we understand the motion of the air and the dissolution of the contaminants from the original source in the entire building.
All right, and Matthias, can you also explain a bit more, or describe also a bit more, the cooperation between your company and Diefenbacher?
I remember that about 10 years ago, the environmental department of Diefenbacher was looking for a strategic partner with deep expertise in fluid dynamics. After we had several successful projects in different fields together, we commonly developed the first air management system for an MDF plant here in Germany. Since then, we continuously improved our common know-how in the field of intelligent exhaust systems.
Matthias, you have mentioned that it is very important to build deep knowledge in the field of air management, fluid mechanics, and so on. But why is it so important, and why can't we use not off-the-shelf solutions?
Good question. Well, you can imagine that the situation in each particular press hall is different and requires own solutions to find the optimal way to an efficient and intelligent air management system. The installed equipment, the shape of the building, as well as the number or the positions of doors or breakthroughs to other parts of the building are never the same in two different locations. For that reason, it is always necessary to audit the local conditions carefully prior to build a CFD model.
Let's discuss more the topic around CFD modeling. How does the approach for the CFD modeling look like?
That's easy. We convert real life into a virtual environment. In a first step, we start to simulate the actual situation in the press hall as some kind of a reference scenario. From the information extracted from this model, we develop dedicated concepts for air extraction and air feeding points. The major advantage of the virtual environment, of course, is that we can try and evaluate different configurations with regard to the local targets in a very cost-efficient way. In the end, we can build optimal setup to get the things right the first time.
Let us be a bit more precise on CFD and provide an even clearer picture for our customers. Can you explain a typical result in a few words?
To underline the result of a CFD engineering, I'd like to show you this picture. In the left column, you can see the formaldehyde concentration profiles on different heat levels in a press hall as it was today operated. The top picture is on ground level, and the bottom one is just below the ceiling. Blue regions represent low concentrations, while on the red zones, the formaldehyde level is very high. In the right column, we compare the formaldehyde on the same levels after application of an intelligent air management. Of course, we cannot eliminate the volatile contaminant completely from inside the building, but we can massively reduce the local concentrations, in particular in the common walkways and working areas. Just for understanding, the formaldehyde concentrations in the reddish zone is 2000% higher than in the greenish.
All right, so the conclusion regarding CFD modeling is that we analyze and understand, then optimize, and finally realize in practice, without trial and error, of course, in order to improve the air quality in the production buildings of our customers.
Yes, exactly.
Matthias, thank you for your time today, explanations, and see you soon in the course of our ongoing and upcoming projects. Thank you very much. We are moving now on to a short video, which gives you an impression of how such CFD simulation visualizes the airflow within a real example, and which is afterwards the basis for the measures that will be taken. Thank you. We hope that this video provides you with an understanding on what is nowadays possible with the state-of-the-art CFD technology and the corresponding benefits. Marius, let us take a look at the shown model, which shows also the measures that can be implemented to improve the air quality in our production buildings all around the world. Each customer will receive an individual concept to improve the air quality. So not every customer will need to implement all those shown measures, or?
Yes, that's right. These are examples depending on the results of our study. We then decide which measures make the most sense in terms of costs and benefits. It is almost always necessary to extract contaminated air concentrated at the emission points. A directed air supply is actually always there as well. If not yet existing, it may be useful to divide the production hall into segments by sheet metal parts under the rooftop. Heat recovery concepts and exhaust gas cleaning systems are options that can be installed if necessary.
When talking specifically now about greenfield projects and new production lines, the intelligent air management is a combination and evaluation of all those points, or?
All the mentioned concepts, components have been proven many times. Nevertheless, we always decide which measures make the sense to include and which can be left out in the individual case together with a customer from day one.
Finally, Marius, let's take a brief look into our product portfolio.
Sure. Here's an overview of equipment we typically supply the customer. We have supply air units available for different air volumes in our portfolio, as well as technical room ventilation with central or decentral cooling systems. In addition, we provide the design and supply of the supply air and exhaust air channel parts with ventilation grills for optimized air distribution. Optionally, we have developed a modular pressure for retrofits and supply emission control systems for the exhaust gas cleaning.
Okay, I think this pretty much covers an introduction of the products and parts that are actually needed for an intelligent air management. Thank you, Marius, for your detailed explanations. I think we were able to create a good overview on Diefenbacher's intelligent air management and why Diefenbacher's know-how in environmental technology is so beneficial to the customer and allows to move forward together.
With pleasure. I really enjoyed to familiarize you all with our matter.
We know, of course, that we have explained a lot in the last minutes. We assume that some questions have been left unanswered or came up during the last minutes. Therefore, we have now the time and will answer all your questions.